Welcome to Up Close and Personal, the show that gives an up close and personal view of the people, places, and events in Nashville that make a difference in our lives and our community. Here's your host, Jennifer Gamble. Welcome to Up Close and Personal. I'm Jennifer Gamble. Love heals. That's what the women of Thistle Farms believe. Thistle Farms is a social enterprise run by women who have survived lives of prostitution, drug addiction, and living on the streets. The women make body care products from the thistle weed, which produces natural creations that are as good for the body as they are for the earth. Stay tuned as we visit Thistle Farms and bear witness to the truth that love is more powerful than all the forces that drive women to the streets.
Meditation off with a moment of silence, followed by the surrender prayer. Prayer.
God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference, just for today.
My name is Sharon, I'm a recovering addict, and I'm reading Find Your Way Home. It's the 12 principles. By the women of Magdalen, and I'm going to read the first principle, and then I'm going to read three stories that is written by three individual women. Okay. Find your place. Spiritual principle four. Find your place in the service. We are a disciplined community that consists of residents, affiliates, graduates, and women on the streets, staff, volunteers, board members, and community partners. We find our place in the circle knowing that it doesn't matter if on that particular day we will be given or received. Guests and newcomers are given priority in the circle. I find this circle is like church for me, at least how church is supposed to feel. It feels like a loving group that is sharing a common goal. And there is no reason to try and take power and give up your voice. I am grateful for the image of the serpent and amazed by the reality of it. I sat in our circle and didn't feel anything. Then the director got up and walked over to a woman sitting near me and started braiding her hair. That is when I felt something growing in me and I wanted to sing. Of course, the feeling was love. I had never sat in such a circle. And I was amazed as I watched her go to the next woman's hair, judging no one and being one of us. It was a comfort to have all the people in the circle be part of it. The circle was soothing and intimate, and it is changing my heart. One morning at dawn, I was walking the streets of Miami, and everything was silent. The only noise came from the creaking of a swinging gate. I had heard people talk about the gates of hell, and I wondered for a moment if I had died in the night and this was really hell. Coming into this circle is like being able to breathe again. In the circle, it feels like I have come up out of water and am tasting life. It is bright and blue. I can see more clearly. I can open my mouth. I can hear the birds and hear the waves. Good morning, my name is Sherry. I'm still recovering at it. I want to say welcome to all visitors and hope everybody have a blessed day.
My name is Cynthia and I came through Magdalen in 2004. I'm a 2006 graduate. I come from a dysfunctional family on both sides. On my father's side of the family was the moonshine and the weed. On my mother's side of the family was party every weekend, we go to church on Sunday. So I grew up to be a confused child. At the age of five, my grandparents stayed in the country in Hickman County, and my grandfather made his own moonshine. They had a still, and I can remember going to spend a night with my grandmother and having to go downstairs to pick up the glasses and the cups from where he was testing his product. And what happened was, I was curious what was coming out of that smell that was coming out of that cup. And let me say that I tried it and I immediately liked it. I just didn't like it going down. At the age of six, I was introduced to marijuana by my father. At the age of 8, I was molested by my first cousin in his teens. At the age of 9.5 years old, I lost my father in a Mary County jail fire back in 1977. And that was the day that I went looking for love in all the wrong places. Me and my mom, I had 3 other siblings, and let me say that me and my mom, we really didn't have a relationship. I was more closer to my father because my father would talk to me about grown-up stuff. And I thought that he loved me and he showed me all the attention, which my mama never did. So when my father died, it crushed me. And I was running looking for that same love that my father would give me. And I ran to the little boys. My mom never talked to me about the birds and the bees. So I really didn't know anything about what a little girl or a little boy do if they do the nasty. I became pregnant at 13. At the age of 16 and a half, I had 3 kids. My mom walked out of my life, not only leaving me and my kids behind, but leaving a sister that was 2 years older than me that I had to teach how to read and write. And let me say, I was angry at God. I was angry at the world. I was scared. I was lonely. I felt abandonment. I felt rejected. I always remember things that people told me, you ain't gonna never be nothing. You ain't gonna never amount to nothing. You're gonna have a house full of kids. That's all played in my head. And let me say, I lived up to everything that somebody told me that I was gonna be. And let me say, at the age of 18, I was introduced to Freebase, which was, I thought, was a weekend drug. At the age of 21, I found the love of my life, and that was crack cocaine. And let me say that the same thing that I said about other people, I turned out to be just like them. I said that I wasn't gonna be like my mama. Guess what? I turned out to be just like my mama. I left my 3 kids on the side of the road trying to jump in the car with the dope dealer to get that one more, not knowing that he was gonna take me up north. And wake up 3 days later, I'm in a crack house looking for my kids. The guilt and the shame kept me not going back to get my kids. To one day, I kept hearing my kids in my ear, and I'm like, you know, I need to get myself together. But that took some years to go back to get my kids. And when I got back, my kids loved me, in spite of me being gone all that time. But let me say that it didn't stop there. You know, my disease got progressive. It got worse and worse. At the time, I started messing around with the same sex. I wouldn't take a bath for days and weeks at a time. I was eating out of the garbage can. I was stealing. I was breaking in my mama's house. The pain was so constant and acute to where I wanted to take my own life. You know, I was living in abandonment houses that didn't have no running water. I would think crack and drinking was enough for me. So that's where I come from. And then at the end of my road, I was standing on the corner, cussing God, asking God, if you really God, and you really God like everybody say you is, why I have to go through all this? Why my life had to be like this? And if you really God, let me die if I take this next hit or send me to jail. Well, I didn't die. 3 days later, I went to jail. And let me say, that was the best day of my life. Because meeting that police on the corner, I was waiting on a date. Guess what? God got a sense of humor, right? He sent a police car to rescue me. And in the back seat of that police car, handcuffed, I began to pray and cry. And I found the Holy Spirit come inside me. And I went to jail for 36 days. Then I got out of jail. And I went to my sister, and I needed her to find me some help. Now, at this point, I realized I need some help. And guess how long it took? It took 27 years. To get out of bondage. And my sister knew my cousin named Regina, that was one of the first five ladies that came through Magdalene. And she used to come home and she used to ask me, "Are you tired?" I'm like, "Nah, girl, I'm having fun," I thought. But that was just to cover up that pain. And at the end of my road, and I think it was like August the 28th, and I said that I was gonna party one more time for my daddy's death. And his birthday was August the 29th, and I got high that day, and I went to my sister, and that was the first time I finally admitted that I had a problem to my family. I'm like, you know, if I take another hit, I'ma die. I don't know how to stop. And my sister, they used to beat me over the head with God. "Girl, you need to find God. You need to pray to God." I did all that. And still couldn't stop. So I said, "I need some help." And she was so happy that I finally came and said, "I need help." But she didn't tell me her husband was in the back room smoking crack. And she left me there with him. But this particular time, something changed. Everywhere I went, I left a message for my sister to find me. And when she found me, it was broad daylight like it is now. I was outside behind a trailer, smoking crack. And when she pulled up to get me, to bring me to Nashville, I kept looking at the crack pipe like, I don't know why. But God had me to keep looking at that crack pipe, and what he did was he allowed my life to go before me. He allowed me to see everything that done to me. Then I made a decision to get in that car and leave. That's when my process started. They brought me to Nashville. They put me in a safe house. They was building the house over on Lena, and they took care of me. And that's when I met Beth. And that's when Becca hugged me. And I didn't want her to hug me because I was still smelling. But she embraced me. And let me say, if I wouldn't have got that hug, I wouldn't be here today. August the 31st is my clean day. This next month, I will have 8 years clean. And I thank God for God. And Becca vision, because if it wouldn't have not been for her vision, I wouldn't be here today. And see, Magdalene changed my life, but this farm gave me a purpose. They gave me a job. Only job I knew was prostituting and shoplifting. And since I've been here, I have learned how to be a productive member of society. I got my education, because when I came in here, I had only a third and a fourth grade education. I couldn't read, but they gave me tutors. Now I can read. I got my diploma. I done wrote a book. I'm married. I'm a homeowner. I'm back into my kids' life. I'm back into my mama's life. You know, it works. Love, healing works. You know, we got to step outside of ourselves to give it and be able to receive it. And that's my story. I'm so happy.
I'm Jennifer Gamble, and I'm here with the founder of Thistle Farms, Miss Becca Stevens. Thanks for joining me today.
I'm so happy to be here. Thank you.
Here at Thistle Farms, you all make natural body products by hand, which mm-hmm. is great in itself. Mm-hmm. But in addition to that, Thistle Farms is a social enterprise that empowers women who have survived addiction and sexual abuse. Mm-hmm. How did you come up with the concept for this program?
Well, actually, the social enterprise came after the residential part of the program. So in 1997, we really wanted to offer sanctuary for women who had been prostituted, trafficked, had known addiction and life on the streets. So we opened up residence, and for 4 years, women were coming in, getting clean and sober. We all come for 2 years. They live rent-free. They get all the medical physical treatment that they need, working on life skills, all kinds of stuff, but people were not hiring the women. The arrest records are amazing. Everyone has criminal records. So our unemployment rate was close to 90%, and that's when the idea, this was in 2001, we were like, let's just start our own business. Let's just do a social enterprise, invite the women to come in and start working. And it made sense to us that we really needed to do something that was healing for the body. So much of what the women had endured had to do with real sexual violence. When the we did the statistics on the first few years of our program, women on average were first raped between the ages of 7 and 11.
So the products you make are healing for the body emotionally as well as physically.
Yes, and what we didn't imagine is that it was going to be so healing for the people that were making the products, that you forget that while you're stirring the lavender in the vats and while you're pouring the candles and mixing the paper with the thistles, that you're getting all the benefits of those essential oils and that you're becoming part of the healing process too, which is how usually love works.
Right.
You know, it washes over everybody. And you get washed in that too.
Wow, that's wonderful. Now, do all of the women who live at Magdalen work here at the Thistle Farms? And how many women do you employ?
We have 6 houses. We have 27 women who are currently in residence. And this morning, I believe, you met 4 of the newer residents who have not come to work at Thistle Farms yet. Everyone is invited to work at Thistle Farms. No one has to work at Thistle Farms. But again, the only reason we started is that people weren't having tons of luck getting work.
What are some of the changes that you've seen in the women who have come into the, since they came into the program?
You know, I was thinking about that this morning and looking at some of the new women that have said that they wanted to come in and start working, and like, this looks like it's going to be a long plane ride. Like, you know, that you wonder, like, I wonder how they're going to do in an environment like this. There's a lot of activity and chaos, and they people look a little bit intimidated and a little dazed. And, you know, people are coming in with a lot of physical and mental issues that they're going to have to deal with. But what happens with every group that comes in is you get blown away by, you know, the resurrection in people's lives that happens when there's healing. And I can't wait. I can't wait for people like to literally come out of themselves and their voices get stronger and they start talking about what it is, like, this is what I'm mad about. This is what I'm hopeful about. This is what I long for. And so, you know, I've seen literally people, to me, what looks like come back to life from almost just a depressed or exhausted space into, like, funny and happy. And
come back to life.
Yeah.
This is wonderful. It sounds like a wonderful program.
One of the new initiatives that we're really excited about at Thistle Farms is that we're opening up a Thistle Stop Cafe. As you saw this morning, we have a lot of visitors and a lot of people coming through. And in this area of town, it is really hard to find a beautiful cup of tea and coffee.
Yes.
All the way down Charlotte to downtown area. So it's going to open up an opportunity for women. It's a new vocational training program, and it's also going to be a gift to the community and another way for people to interact and develop community together inside the cafe. Our theme is A Story in Every Cup, and it's called the Thistle Stop Cafe.
Sounds great. More natural products?
All natural products,
oh,
absolutely.
Wow, sounds wonderful. Well, we'll look forward to that coming soon.
Thank you.
This is wonderful. It sounds like a wonderful program. And
thank you.
I applaud you and thank you for what you're doing in our community.
Well, I applaud and thank you, too. I mean, community access is really a labor of love as well, so congratulations on doing what you're doing.
Now, can we get a tour of the facility?
Yes, you can. I'd love to see you take a whole tour of this big new facility because we just really have moved in about a year and a half ago, so it's still new to us, too.
Great. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
And this kit is called sandal kit, and this, the reason why you see this purple tag, it represents women's freedom. And we launched this when we our 10th year anniversary. We came up with women freedom, and it comes with a body butter, a body polish, and purple fingernail polish with a fingernail file. And we launched this, and we had some of the news reporters to paint their fingernails purple and send them back to us and put them on Facebook. We had musicians to paint their fingernails and their toenails purple. And what we did, we launched all of these people that painted their toenails and their fingernails, and we made this big old, it's like a big old website. Even men, they painted their toenails and their fingernails because they had somebody that was struggling. No matter what your struggle is, we are trying to break the men's and allow people to get free, no matter what your freedom is, you know. And Becca, she said that she is my role model, and because she said pain do not discriminate. And everybody got some brokenness in their life. If they really get honest and say, your struggle may not be my struggle, but if you really look inside, that everybody got some brokenness that's trying to get some freedom from. So she couldn't have said it a better way. Wow. And we also make thistle paper. We go harvest the thistles. You see the wild, ugly weed along the highway? It's got, looks like it's got thorns, and then it's got this purple center. Well, that's called a thistle. And the reason why our name is called thistle is because when a lady is coming in off the streets, we represent that weed. We rough, we rebellious, we don't know who to trust. So Becca came up with thistle, not knowing that that was a weed that was gonna restore women's liver. Because some of the ladies come in here with hepatitis C and D. And once they start making the thistle paper and put their hand in the water, a lot of ladies has been restored to where they cannot find hepatitis, nothing in their body. And we that's thistle paper. We also make thistle journals. We also make bookmarks. And they in the process of making thistle bird houses out of the thistle paper. And it is so awesome to be able to see how creative they getting to be. Because when I came here, we started with four products. And that was just, and it was in aluminum cans. And that was just a body balm, the body, we had like sea salt, scrub, and we had a candle and a lip balm. That was it when I came on board. So now you can imagine being almost 8 years into the program, how you can see God just working with just an idea. We have a lady that labeled our products. We have ladies that put stickers on our products. We just have different teams of workers here that some just make the products, some label the products. Then we also have, this is our last stop to putting our products on the shelf, is when they come over here and they shrink wrap our products. And it's very important that we shrink wrap our products, is because even though when our products go on the shelf or in the store, they cannot use it. And we put shrink wrap on it so we can protect ourselves. And all of our products have to get shrink wrap, even down to the lip balm. The only thing that don't be shrink wrap is our shower gels. Everything else is being shrimp wrapped at this particular time. And this is a finished product right here. This is a finished product that cannot break the seal. And that's what they are trying to do, is protect the seal and our product so can nobody break it open and test it.
What's the biggest selling product?
The biggest selling product right now is our body butter. And We have Six Scent, we have Tuscan Herb, Citrus Vanilla, Lavender, Lemon Sage, Unscented, and we have Tea Treatment. So them is our, if all of our products have all of them products. We have Body Balm, we have Body Butter, Body Polish, we have a candle, we have shower gels, we have hand soap, and our products is just growing.
Make all of the products by hand?
We make all of our products by hand, and the women of Mandarin, and some of the graduates is the ones that's on board. We also have some volunteers that come and help wipe down, but the products is made by the ladies of Mandarin.
Is all of that done in this room?
It's all done in this room right here. Our product is not organic, they all natural. Mm-hmm.
Now, do you only sell here at the store? Do you have a distribution?
We have 263 stores.
Okay.
We are all in the northeast, southeastern region.
Okay.
We just came from North Carolina to go into our newest stores. We're also in South Carolina. We're in Chattanooga. We're in all the stores in Atlanta. We are in Franklin, Tennessee, in Cool Springs, and we in Green Hills. So we growing as we speak.
Issafarms.org, click on store.
But you can also buy products here.
I'd like to thank the women of Thistle Farms for allowing me to give you an up-close and personal view of the work they do to rebuild lives and inspire positive change in the community through love healing. For more information about Thistle Farms and their all-natural body care products, call 615-298-1140. Thanks for watching. Tune in next time for more Up Close and Personal.